Church doesn't go without money. The church doesn't go without anything. God supplies from his riches and glory through Christ Jesus. And the Lord has become the shepherd, and he's watching over the church. So the Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. So there's no want to the church. And he's become the shepherd and the bishop of the church. He shed his blood for the church. And the blood being shed is never going to lose its power. So however God wants to take care of the church, he can take care of it. As long as we don't get in the way with our words and the things that we have to say about it, you know. And we can't become cheap. Cheap people, they take a dollar and that's all they got, you know. They wrap it up. You can tell that it's a poverty spirit. Cheap people are always looking for the cheapest thing they can find, the best deal they can find. How about just doing what God said to do? When he wants you to give $1,000, you give $1,000. You meet people's needs. It's not about you anymore, it's about Jesus. Excuse me. I want you to go with me to 1 Corinthians. This is not planned. You know, I know I tell you that a lot. But I had planned to talk to you about the curse of violence. But God's got something else he wants to do. Yeah, I need you to stay here. Come up here, brothers. Can you come up here? Let me ask you something. If God had a miracle for you today, could you receive it? So, could you be walking without that tractor? That thing over there? I've been hearing for several days now that I'm supposed to pray with you today, and God's going to give you a miracle. And I asked Shannon to pray with us too. Now, what I believe in is I see you walking away from that thing, and I'm not making fun of that. That's okay. That's helped you. But I felt like the Lord was saying, whatever was wrong with her body, I'm going to straighten it out. I'm going to make it whole. I need to feel his anointing. You feel that anointing? Mm-hmm. She's got that anointing too. Mm-hmm. So in the name of Jesus, by the power of the Holy Spirit, we just pray for you right now. Love the Lord. This is something that he has stored up for you because you love him. Okay? That's what he's got for me to speak about in 2 Corinthians. But eye has not seen nor heard, neither has entered into the hearts of man the things which God has prepared for them that love him. So there's several of you in here today. I can hear God calling your names. That it's time for your miracle. Is that all right? Mm-hmm. I have prepared this time for you to give you a miracle. So, Father, we just release the miracle right now to Rose. And we thank you for doing your miracle. We had a lady in Russia who had 9 bad discs. And this is my interpreter, see. And we both laid hands on her. We never felt a thing. But we knew God was doing a miracle. God was creating a new smile for her. So whatever's needed for Rose, Lord, because you've already said you're not done with her. You already said it's not a finished deal, that you're not done with her. So help her to walk, help her to move, help her to be everything that she's supposed to be, and make all these organs and veins and arteries and nerves go back to normal, better than normal. And you are her shepherd. She shall not want. Lead her into the green pastures. Lead her into the still waters. Totally restored. Totally restored by you, Jesus. And today is your miracle. In Jesus' name. Now, I want you to do something for me. I want you just to walk. Is that any better?
Yes.
Turn around when you can. Yes. Did you feel something to do that?
Yes.
Now, I need you to be truthful with me. You telling me the truth?
Yes.
Okay. Did you lift up your legs? Were you hurt? Were you in pain? No. Why didn't you use that then?
I didn't have to.
You didn't have to?
I've been not using it for quite a little while.
Okay. So God's just affirming what you already know is real.
Yes.
Jenna, you got anything else for her? Okay.
Thank you.
Anybody else that needs to come, I'm not going to get into the service until we're done praying this morning. Come on, Mr. Ryan. Now, you're going to have to hold fast to the Word.
Yes.
You're going to have to make sure that the Word is working for you. I don't want you to sit down, I want you to stand up. Now, I know you just got out of the hospital, and they said you had pneumonia. Is that over with?
He put me on some antibiotics, but I took all the antibiotics up, so it didn't matter.
Mm-hmm.
But when I was in the hospital, he gave me medicine through to put the pneumonia, two antibiotics, you know, on that rash. And, he told me I didn't have no COVID, but I had an ITI, but the second time when they did, but everything come out fine.
You know what all that she's talking about? Right. We're expecting all of it to go.
Yes.
Totally healed.
Yes.
Okay? And this is your day for health and healing. Now, you stand in the Word, and you will have to do that on your own.
Yeah.
Lord, we lay hands on the right. Wow.
Oh, my spirit there. So when all over me, all together, I feel it in the name of Jesus. I claim it in the name of Jesus. No more pneumonia and no more ITI and no more.
You've been through enough.
Yeah, I've been through a lot.
Yes.
All right. Same thing with those legs. All of this works the way it's supposed to. In the name of Jesus. Anybody else? I want Herbie up here. Get another chair. I'm calling you because God's saying I'm holy. I'm not calling you because I know, I really don't know where you stand. But as it is written, eye has not seen nor heard, neither has entered into the heart of man the things which God has prepared for them that love Him. And you're quiet, you're staying to self, but God knows your heart. And God knows what's in there. And God knows what He's going to put in there. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. This is the day for Herb's miracle. Herb, receive from me, your master, your savior, your redeemer. So I have done this work for you, that you could be free. No more suffering. No more anxieties. And I cut off the things in the spirit world that have been against you. I release you from those. And I put in your heart the things that I desire for you. And for what is about to come to pass for you. Won't be by might, nor by power, it'll be by my spirit. You hear, you listen, and you obey. And I already know that, says the Spirit of God. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord, for your impartation. The power of my glory is at work. They go home with you. Ooh, ooh. They go home with you. In my glory, I change everything. I make all things new. And I restore. And I revive. And I bring about. I see you fishing and catching bigger fish than you've ever caught. But I also see you fishing for men the way the Lord wants you to. And catching bigger fish for Him than He's ever caught. Ooh. I don't know what's happening to you, but I'm changing. Praise God. How you moving? Anybody else?
Jesus.
Can you come up here? Lord's telling me to talk to you. He's working on your behalf. And He's bringing about miracles. I don't know anything about your family, but there's family members that you have that are not on the same page where you are. Okay. But the Lord says they're coming. And just to be gentle and kind to them. And you won't understand them at first, but just be gentle and kind the way the Lord wants you to, and then He's going to change everything. It's going to be like, bam, and it's all going to change. Okay? Praise God. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Now, there's something about money with you, and He's going to bring finances. He's going to bring peace to you and financial wealth and all of those kind of things that are going to help you. Okay. He said, I'm on your side. Not me. God is on your side. And He's going to see to it that everything is straightened out for you. And He And said, tell you one thing. He said he loves you with all of his heart. But you do deserve that. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. That's because you've been hurt so deep. But the hurt is going away, and the love is coming. Greater and greater and greater. Greater and greater. Thank you, ma'am. You got anything else you need to say? Anything you want to preach? I wish you would just take a minute and thank the Lord for what He's doing.
Yes.
Maybe I need you to come up here, please. Stanley, come over. Thank you, Lord, for what you're doing. Thank you for your miracles. Thank you for your signs and your wonders. To stand beside. I'm joining you two together in ways that you know not know. But just because you love me and because I love you. There's a holiness that will come from the throne of Almighty God. And it will contain the fire and the blessing that you have never known. I'll give you dreams, Nevada, that will tell you of your future. Trust me, both of you, trust me, and know that I am God. I'm working in you. Let me keep working. Keep seeking me, keep looking for me. Take the time set apart to you in Jesus' name. I don't know what's going on with you. I haven't asked any questions, but you're the healer of Almighty God. Amen. Anybody else? Come on, brother. I got Dwayne. Devontae, I'm sorry. I'll get it after a while. Anything special that you have need of? He's got three more real estate courses that he needs to take, and he needs the finances to go with that. And I told him when he got his first $100, I'd give him another $100. So he's got that promise. And maybe you've got a dollar or two or ten away. And are you working?
Got every coming up this Tuesday.
Okay. Okay. Father, we thank you for what you're doing in Devontae's life. Make all of this come together and especially bring out your perfect will to him. In Jesus Christ's name. Fill him with the Holy Ghost. Let him speak in other tongues. Let him get into worship and praise of you and seeking you and looking for you in Jesus Christ's name. Amen. Pray for him where you stand. Come on, we pray for Rodney. We just thank you for Rodney's healing and his heart. And the curses over his heart are broken. And that Rodney's free from the medication and free in his heart to keep going with the happy Rodney that we knew. In Jesus Christ's name. Amen. You know, Georgia had a week off. Did you know that? I've got to get into this 2 Corinthians chapter 2. So if you don't mind, if you go back to verse 2, that's where I am right now. I'm on the edge here, and I know what God has told me to do, but I don't know everything. Okay? So it's like Paul, for I determined in verse 2 of 1 Corinthians, chapter 2, verse 2, for I determined not to know anything among you save Jesus Christ and Him crucified. And I was with you in weakness and in fear and in much trembling. Now, I don't know if I was doing all that, but I know the Lord kept talking to me about this is what He wanted. And my speech and my preaching was not with enticing words of man's wisdom, but in the demonstration of the Spirit and of power, that your faith should not stand in the wisdom of men, but in the power of God. Amen. So when He was talking to you today, the power of God was being released to you. You hear me?
Amen.
All right? And He's doing that on purpose. Bring about His will with you. Now, I used to stop right there. But if you go down to verse 6, howbeit we speak wisdom among them that are perfect, yet not the wisdom of this world, nor the princes of this world that come to naught. But we speak the wisdom of God and the mysteries, even the hidden wisdom which God ordained before the world unto our glory. So God had glory for us before the world was formed. There was a glory that's God's glory. And what I want you to see out of this message is this is what God has stored up for us that love Him. And if there's one in here, which I don't see one, but if there's one that doesn't know the Lord, now's the time to know Him. Now's the time to get into this part of His life for us. His life for us is not over. Because God is saying, just to people who love Him. You know, and if I stop and tell you about different things and different ways that I love on the Lord, it wouldn't be the same as you do. You know, I got a granddaughter that she sees God operate through the things of the world. And she loves the Lord with all her heart, and she's been filled with the Spirit and so forth. But she can look at a plant and tell you all about that plant, and tell you what God did to get it to grow and everything else, you know. And we had a guy that was a Episcopal church up in Cartersville. And he told me, he says, come on, go with me. I want you to walk with me for a little while, and I'll show you where I see God. And he took me to a beautiful waterfall. And he said, that's where I see the Lord. So you can see the Lord in nature, but you can also see the Lord in material things, and you can see the Lord in supernatural things. He wants you to see Him in all those things. And He wants you to love Him in all of those things. And when you get to the place where you love Him so much, where you can just take all your life and say, okay, whatever you want to do with me, go ahead and do it. You know, you just release yourself. Why? Because this is somebody that loves you more than anybody else could ever love you. This is somebody that's on your side more than anybody else could be on your side. All right, and then I'm going to go on, verse verse 7. But we speak the wisdom of God in mysteries, even the hidden wisdom which God ordained before the world unto our glory, which none of the princes of this world knew, for had they known it, they would not have crucified the Lord of glory. They didn't realize who was backing up the Lord of glory. You know, and all the other avenues of God and all the other fullness of God, they didn't realize. They thought, we'll just get Jesus. Well, there's more to Jesus than just getting Jesus. They didn't know that. But the glory of God was still on the throne. Hello. And when he died on the cross and went to hell, and he's laying there, and Satan saying, I got him, I got him. But he didn't got him. Because he had a commandment from God. You can lay down your life when you get ready to, and you can pick it up again when you get ready to. And that's why he believed and he confessed. And his miracle in his own life was that I'm going to die, but after 3 days I will rise again.
Yes.
And God sent his glory. I wish people could get a hold of that, because you're going to see that the glory has everything to do with everything else that you're blessed in. It's the glory of God. It's the glory that brought you into grace. It's the glory that manifests forth when God's healing and God's doing all these other things. It's his presence, it's his glory, it's his light, whatever you want to call it. That's what it is. And he goes on in verse 9, which we read a couple of times, but as it is written, eye has not seen, nor has the ear heard, neither has entered into the heart of men the things which God has prepared for them that love him. And, you know, if I ask a foolish question, you'd give me the right answer. Do you love him? Yeah. And out of you all that are here, you know, that's really foolish. Because we know that we love God. We know that God is the one that's on our side. We know that we know the promises of God. Yea, and amen. All right. And then verse 10, but God has revealed them unto us by his Spirit. For the Spirit searcheth all things, yea, the deep things of God. For what man knoweth the things of a man, save the spirit of man which is in him? Even so, the things of God knoweth no man but the Spirit of God. So the Holy Spirit's got to be involved in your life in order to give you these revelations and give you these things that God has for you. So when God is telling you to trust him or just keep moving with him, and allow him to do what he wants to do, you know, he's actually making plans for you. He's not really planning for himself. He's bringing about the plan that he made before the foundation of the world for you. All right? Now, some things we can get from the Word of God. I want you to go with me into Ephesians chapter 1. Paul was saying, in a nutshell, I'm coming to demonstrate the things of God. I don't know what the Holy Spirit's going to give me, but I'm going to demonstrate what God has for you and what he wants to say to you. So that's what today is. This is actually a demonstration of the Spirit and power. Because, you know, and you've heard me say this so many times, I'm sure you get tired of me repeating it, but it's not in my notes. Ephesians chapter 1, verse 2, grace to you and peace from God the Father and from the Lord Jesus Christ. So how did I get grace and peace? I got both of them because of God the Father and because of the Lord Jesus Christ. Then in verse 3, blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who has blessed us with all spiritual blessings in heavenly places in Christ. All spiritual blessings that are in Christ are in you, and they are yours from heaven. All God's got to do is open your ears and your eyes and your heart to receive what He's wanting you to receive. Lord, what do you want to give me? Lord, what do you want me to receive? Lord, what do you want me to have? Well, He says, I want you to have all spiritual blessings. Why? Because we are not the ones that are out of sin. We're the ones that have been saved. We're the ones that belong to Him. We're the ones that are filled with the Holy Spirit. We're the ones that can go daily and pray and seek the Lord and praise Him and honor Him and bless Him. Hello? This is a set apart family of Almighty God. All spiritual blessings. Where are they? They are in heavenly places in Christ. So if I see myself in Christ, I'm closer to those blessings than I've ever been before. And Christ will honor me the same way God the Father honors me, because we love Him. Are you in love with Him? Yeah. You singing songs to Him during the day? I woke up with one yesterday, and I just had it for 3 or 4 hours, you know, trying to remember all the words and just singing to the Lord. And it had to do about the blood, you know, and it just was a song I hadn't heard in a long time. And I wish now I had written it down so I could go look it up, but I didn't do that yesterday. But here you go on for hours just singing that song. You know, nobody was home. Linda was on her way back from Mississippi. That's why she's not here today. She's resting up. But we're just having that time with the Lord. And sometimes your time is on your knees. Sometimes it's when He just starts something and you're out working or something. I had some projects to do in the yard, so I was working on that as much as I could. Then I'd go in and sit down and take a rest and get me another bottle of water. And then go out and do some more, and He'd still be singing. He's still singing from down in my spirit. So the things that I'm hearing is what He wants me to hear right then. But I tell Him, don't stop. Amen. Amen. Don't stop telling me what you want to tell me. You know, and if there's something I'm doing that you don't like, you need to tell me about that too.
Amen.
So that I can get rid of it and straighten it out. You see what we're talking about? This is somebody that you love and somebody that loves you. And I don't know about you, but this is the relationship that I was looking for all my life and didn't know it.
Yes, amen.
Anybody else?
Yes, Lord.
Somebody to care about me the way He does and never fudge on what He's saying. Never change what He's thinking. Hello? Now, go on a little bit more. Verse 4. According as He, and that's the Father, has chosen us in him before the foundations of the world, that we should be holy and without blame before him in love. Now, that's something that a lot of Christians don't get a hold of. They're too busy trying to please God instead of accepting the love that he already has for them. He said, I'm blameless. He said, you're blameless. He said, you're holy, without blame, before him in love. Come on, he's already established that. He says, that's already ours. That's already his. That's the way he sees us 24/7. This is Paul writing this stuff. You know, Paul was killing Christians. And Paul said, I got forgiven because I did it out of ignorance. Well, there's a lot of things I did out of ignorance too. And God forgave them. God wiped them off the sheet. You know, God erased them. But he hadn't taken my name out of the book. Pastor Robert Morris, he preached a message about being human and being supernatural. And he said sometimes when he's human, God just tightens him up a little bit and says, now you're going to have to straighten this situation out before we go any further. And sometimes it has to do between him and his wife, you know. Something he said to her too hard, or something he said to her in the wrong tone. And God won't anoint him until he goes back and asks her to forgive him. Hello? So he's already hearing. See, he's already hearing from God. He's already knowing what God is saying. He's got to go straighten it out. But then he used Peter for a lot of his demonstrations. And Peter asked a lot of questions when nobody was asking him anything. But Peter gave a lot of answers. You know, Peter just run his mouth too much many times. Anyway, verse 4. According as he has chosen us in him before the foundations of the world. You're chosen of Almighty God before he even made the world. Who else would do that? He puts you on his agenda and on his heart by name before the world was established. Jesus said in John 17, he said, put me back where I was before the world, before the foundations of the world. When I'm coming back to you, put me back where I was and give me everything I had before. But he said, now I want them to come with me. I want them to be seated in heavenly places with me. I want them to know and see my glory. Even the Lord, before the foundations of the world, this decision for him to come for us was made. For him to forgive our sins was done. This wasn't a new plan. This wasn't plan B or plan C. I don't think there is any plan B or plan C. God's got one plan, and it's you. And he's going to work with you and work with you until he gets it the way he wants it. Until you work with him. A lot of people standing against us. That's what's going on right now in Israel. There's a lot of pain over there. But Israel has done a lot of things that God asked them not to do. So are you creating your own suffering? Or is it really coming from the devil? Jim, would you turn this row of lights down so that that one just keeps blinking too much? See, there's a part of what Israel has gone through that started, thank you, before the flood. And God saw the spirit that was operating through those people, and he got Noah and his family, and he said, everything else is going to die. And in Genesis 6:11, he said the violence. And that white word for violence is the very name that these people have taken that are coming against Israel. Hamas, which is in the Hebrew, that's their name. But that's not every Palestinian. There are a lot of Palestinians that love God. That's not every white person that is an idiot or whatever you want to call it. That's not every black person. But it's difficult to root out something sometimes. Scripture says in the Old Testament that God, when he's ready, he will do away with Hamas. He will obliterate it. And probably until then, Israel's going to have to fight it. And other people will help him. I hadn't made up my mind yet how to help him. And God hadn't talked to me about how to help him. A lot of mail comes from Israel all of a sudden. And they're asking for this and they're asking for that. I got them. I'm praying, but I don't hear anything from the Lord. God's working on us. Verse 5, having predestinated us unto the adoption of children by Jesus Christ through himself, according to the good pleasure of his will. Your adoption cannot be taken away from you. God adopted you into his family by fire, by him saying, these are mine. And they will know that I'm their God, and they will say, I am his child. And there's no reverse to his adoption. I wish you'd get a hold of that. See, because a lot of people are still trying to please God. I did a funeral for a man, and I didn't have all the facts, but I treated him like he was a born-again Christian. But they kept telling me he had a good heart, you know. He did good things. But that doesn't mean he's going to get to heaven. You're going to get to heaven because you know Jesus. Because you have accepted Jesus. If Jesus Christ is not your Lord, you're not going to heaven. You can be the best man on the planet, but without Jesus, you're going straight to hell. I don't know how to say it any plainer than that. And it's not hard to find Jesus. It's easy. It's the easiest thing in the world you'll ever do. Lift up your hands and say, Lord Jesus, if you're really there, come into my heart. Come and take over in my life. Lord Jesus, I don't know if you can save me or not, but come and get me. and he'll come and get you. It's not a fancy prayer. It's not even praying necessarily the scripture. But the scriptures will help you. But he'll get you into the scriptures. He'll help you learn the scriptures after you're born again. I preached about how easy it was to receive Jesus, and two people came up and got saved. That was in Germany. One of them was a very rich lady, and the other one was a gypsy man. Both of them sat down and wept and cried afterwards. And they kept telling me that the German lady is very rich. I said, good, maybe she put some money in the church. She told me, she says, I don't know what the Lord did to me, but I felt the heat go through my body. I said, well, you just believe that that's the power of God, and that's the presence of His glory, and you let it come through you the way you want to. Amen. Adoption is a fire. The fire cannot be taken away from God, and the fire cannot be taken away from you. So adoption has no reverse. That's important. Because you know, you need to know Jesus Christ is my Lord. Jesus Christ is my Savior. Jesus Christ has brought me back into relationship with my Heavenly Father. And Father God, you are there for me. Whether I have a father or if I don't have a father, you come and take care of me. Hello? And see, the glory is a fire. So the glory of God is something that God displays for the church. When he comes in glory for Rose, for Herbie, for those that he touched today. Those that he's working on. And I think every prayer will be answered. Yes. And I think every time you give money, God knows it and writes it down and puts it in a book. And he's going to reverse it and it's going to come back to you. Am I giving again? Not necessarily. I'm giving because I love the Lord. Amen. Come on, these things are real. These things are true. This is where our heart is. And God has taken the time when we got born again to open both of our ears and our eyes so we can see revelation and we can hear what God is saying by His voice. Amen? Both ways. All right, I want to continue with this just a little bit. Verse 6, I'm still in in Ephesians chapter 1, to the praise of the glory of His grace, wherein He has made us accepted in the beloved. When I first saw that, one of the things that I've been battling was rejection. And this tells me that the Christ loves me. That God the Father loves me, and He has accepted me, so He won't reject me. If I sin, I'm still not rejected. If I do what's right, I'm not rejected. If I make a mistake, I'm not rejected. If somebody doesn't like me and they spill all kinds of garbage on me, that's not rejecting me from God, that's Satan. Jesus made some statements. And he said, I'm going to find it. You have to excuse me. I'm not passionate about these things. Jesus made these statements. I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to me except, no one comes to the Father except through me. That's in John chapter 14, verse 6.
Amen.
Jesus said to him, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. You cannot get to Father God. You can call your God God, but it's not the same as Jehovah.
Yes, yes, yes.
Okay? What's so bad about some of these criminals is this stuff is ingrained in them from the time they're born. They don't know anything else. They just know to destroy Israel. Iran talks about U.S. and America and calls America the big Satan. Iran talks about Israel and calls Israel the little Satan. Iran has already set themselves to destroy America and destroy Israel. They'll say it openly. So if we don't have somebody in the government that's willing to protect us and take care of us and keep up a good military, we got a problem. And the same way Israel opened this attack for so many people to die, we could do the same thing. You thought 911 was something. I don't think we've seen anything yet. Now, this is the Father who loves me. This is Jesus who cares about us. He has even adopted us into his family. Yet sometimes, people who know him go through trouble, and the trouble is greater than they are. Don't you turn to God and say, God, where are you? God, why aren't you helping me? That's the wrong way. Go to God and say, thank you, God. You got a way for me to get out of this. Or do like I did. Years ago, I took that right hand and I said, you better get a hold of me because I'll let go of you. But I know you won't let go of me. And now when things get rough, I told the Lord, I said, okay, Lord, pull me through it. Pull me through it. Or show me how to get through it. Because this is too much for me to be going on. Now the other day, I was seeking the Lord. And then I went out and I was working to do some work I had to do out in the yard. And then I came back in and I heard the Lord say, go lay in my presence for 10 minutes. I ran in the bedroom. I didn't really run, but I got in there as quick as I could. And I laid down across the bed. And I said, okay, you know what happens a lot of times when I do this? And I started praying in the Spirit. And about 45 minutes later, I woke up. And I said, okay, this was supposed to be 10 minutes in your presence. And here I've been sleeping. But he did something. See, obedience to God is what's so important. And he did something in that time where I was sleeping. And something happened in my body that couldn't have happened if I didn't go in there and lay in his presence. Hello? Y'all all right with this?
Amen.
Okay. Accepted and to be loved. I thought I was going to preach on that one week. I ended up preaching on it several different times. And when it started, it went for 4 weeks. For the forgiveness of sins, according to the riches of His grace. See, acceptance has come to you because of His grace. But the grace came to you because of His glory. Oh, yeah. This may not be exciting to you, I don't know. Verse 7, in whom we have redemption through His blood, the forgiveness of sins according to the riches of His grace. Grace and the blood of Jesus have wiped out everything that was against you. Grace and the blood of Jesus have taken all that was disrespectful to God and washed it out and literally has destroyed it. Grace and the blood of Jesus brought you to the place where sin is not a factor in your life any longer. That's a hard one for people to get a hold of. That's one that I'm still digesting. You know, but John said at the end of his first epistle, he says, the righteous don't sin. The spirit of a righteous man cannot sin. You heard that before? That's you. That's us. The spirit in you cannot sin. So if there's sin in you, it's coming from the soulish realm or the flesh. And it's not there from God because He already sees you as blameless. He's already accepted you into beloved. He's already shed the blood to get rid of sin. As far as the east is from the west, you can't find your sin any longer. And He said, back in 2 Corinthians, let me find it again. Can you put that back up there, verse 9? But as it is written, eye has not seen, nor ear heard, neither has entered into the hearts of men the things which God has prepared for them that love Him. Just go on loving Him. Just go on making a difference in your life with Almighty God. That's what the Lord said today. And I will find you, and I will drop things into your spirit, because you are my child. You can't get away from my adopting you. I don't want you to get away from being my child, and I would just drop it into your spirit. That woman right there, Maxine, she'll get somebody on the phone, and she'll start talking to him. And the next thing you know, she's talking to him by the Spirit of Almighty God. And she's saying things to them that are coming out of her spirit. How'd they get in her spirit? They got in her heart. And God's telling them what she's supposed to be saying, and she's saying it, and it's changing those people.
Amen.
In every case? Well, not every case, no. But she's done it a lot of times. I've had it happen a lot of times. Come on. God sent you somewhere, and He put something in your heart for the people that you're in front of, or for the one that you're dealing with. Now, go to Luke 16:16. Until John came, there were the law and the prophets. Since then, the good news, the gospel of the kingdom of God is being preached, and everyone strives violently to go in. John 16:16. I'm in the Amplified. Amplified says, people force their own way rather than the way of God to get in there. People push to do it their own way instead of the way that God wants them to. All right? John 6, 44 and 45. No man, John 6, 44, no man, this is Jesus talking, no man can come to me except the Father that sent me draw him, and I will raise him up at the last day. It is written in the prophets, and they shall all be taught of God. Everyone that has heard from the Father and has learned comes unto me. So when the Father was drawing me to Jesus, I just fell into a plan with the church that we had, and they asked me to help. And I was part of the help that was going on to bring about this faith alive. I didn't even know what it was. But I was just glad to help. And in the middle of all that help, God was showing me something about Jesus. And that man was sitting up there playing his guitar and making funny jokes and had everybody laughing and doing all his little bitty songs, you know, glory to the Lord and Jesus, name above all names. So all the songs. But he had a light about him. There was a glory about him. You couldn't take it away from me. And I told God, I said, God, whatever he's got, I want it. And you know what I was living on? When I made my first communion at 8 years old, I was walking into the house all alone. And I said, God, if this is really you, and you can work it out, would you give me a bike for my first communion? And when they had first communion, and it was over, and they went back to the house, and this was a big deal. This was a big time. I knew I was forgiven. An 8-year-old boy, I knew I was forgiven of my sins. I didn't know it would stay that way, but I knew I was forgiven. And here comes my stepfather up out of the basement. We had those double doors, and you had to go underground to get into the basement. And he's got a beautiful Schwinn bike. And he said, we got this for your communion. And I knew God had heard me. I knew God had heard my prayer. Come on, I still didn't know Jesus. I knew Jesus had forgiven me. But nobody told me I had to accept Jesus as my Lord. Hello? Amen. So I'm dealing with God. But when that man was playing all his silly little songs, and I said, I want what he's got, God. God, give me what he's got. And when we went to the altar, who do I get? That guy with the light all around him. And he said, what do you want? I said, I want what you got. See, I didn't know how to pray a sinner's prayer. There's no such thing as a sinner's prayer to somebody that's already in church. Been sitting in there 33 years, lost as can be. What did Jesus say in John 6? No man can come to me except the Father that sent me draw him. So God the Father was drawing you to Jesus before you got saved. Amen. Don't tell me he don't know a sinner.
Yes.
Some people want to say he don't hear sinners.
Yes, he does.
I don't believe that.
Come on.
God heard my prayer.
Yeah.
I was a sinner sitting in church for 33 years. Are you hearing me?
Yeah.
same God that's got all these things to put in your heart because you love Him.
Amen.
Because you desire Him. Because you seek Him. Because you're looking for Him.
Amen. Yes.
My God. My God. Now, it's still in chapter 6. See, he said three different times he's talking about his relationship to the Father and your relationship to Father God. Now, in John 6:64, but there are some of you that that believe not. For Jesus knew from the beginning who they were that believed not, and who it was that should betray him. And he said, now this is the Lord talking, for this cause I have said unto you, that no man can come unto me except it be given unto him of the Father. So Father has a basis inside of you that he's working on to get you back to heaven. You're transferred from the darkness realm to the realm of the light because of God the Father pulling on you, drawing on you. Now Father's talking to you. Now Father's saying things to you. Now Father's exercising His will as your Father. And your adoption is real and true.
Amen.
And you're accepted in the beloved. And you cannot be rejected any longer. Jesus said, no way. Anybody who comes to me, I will in no wise cast him out. And being cast out is rejection. Hello? He's never come and said, oh, I have a headache today, so you just come back tomorrow. Oh, my stomach hurts. And I don't have time for that. Oh, I got too much going on. And I can't help you today. Just come back tomorrow. It's not the Lord.
Amen.
It's something else, but it's not the Lord.
Mm-hmm.
Now, almost done. John 6:66. Can you find that? Only place in the Bible with 3 sixes. And what do people do? Upon this, many of his disciples went back and walked no more with him. What's he been talking to them about in John chapter 6? Communion. Eat of my body, drink of my blood. And they had a hard time with that. They said, we can't go any further with you. John's the only one that's got a 666. Because they're all walking away from him. He had like 120 that were possible disciples. And then he went on and he asked the 12, he says, well, are you going away from me too? And Peter, with his free mouth, he says, Lord, where would we go? You're the Christ. And he got that revelation from God the Father. So where will you go? Now, let's end this. This has been different for me. Brothers and sisters are not coming to Jesus, they're deceived. And it may be time to tell them.
Amen.
If your family is wrapped up in religion, they're deceived. And they could be as lost as hell. And they may already belong to Satan. But when God gets in their life, they'll come out of the demonic and into the kingdom of Almighty God.
Amen.
John the Baptist came, and this Amas cut off his head. Paul came, gave his life to the Lord, and that same spirit cut off his head. Peter came, and Jesus told him, when you're older, they're going to take your life away from you. And he told them, he said, hang me upside down. I don't want to hang the way my Lord did. Now, the spirit of Hamas, the spirit that's coming against Israel, he tried to boil John in oil. He wouldn't boil. He tried to poison him. He wouldn't poison. God had taken care of that in Mark chapter 16. He said, if you eat any deadly thing, it won't harm you. The devil tried to get rid of Paul with the bite of the snake, and the snake wouldn't harm him. Hello? So you're going to fight some battles. And this spirit that's coming against Israel is a tough one. But you'd better take your time with the Lord. You'd better spend your time in intercession and in prayer. And you need to know who you belong to. Because it's no longer a guessing game. You're on the right side. You're not here just to get a few extra dollars. You're not here just to get a few blessings. You're here for everything that God has. And he probably has more for you than you've ever even thought about. You might be satisfied with the house you have, and it's a $150,000 home. And God's got something for $500,000 that somebody's just going to give you to live in. You might be satisfied with the vehicle you own, and God's just got somebody that's going to give you a couple of brand new ones. Well, how's he going to do that? When you start living for him, when you sell out, he's got a plan. He's got a plan for every one of our lives. Don't give in to this spirit. Antichrist has been here for a long time. Antichrist was against John when he wrote in 1 John. That's the spirit of Antichrist. Antichrist is this Hamas. They work the same way. Antichrist is always trying to build something against God. He's always trying to turn you away from God. And so is this spirit. It's an oppressor. So you're going to have to learn to shake it off. Abraham and Sarah. She and he, two of them together, got him a new wife. They invited the spirit into their house and into their camp. And she told Abraham, says, cast out that spirit. Cast out that boy and his mama. What do you cast out? You cast out spirits. This Hamas spirit, Hamas, H-A-M-A-S, is a spirit that's already in America. It's all over the world. You see the people in England demonstrating in the streets. There were thousands of them. They live there. This is a Muslim. This is a Hindu. This is a spirit that's infiltrating the church. This is a karate spirit. Oh, it's okay to do it in the church. Is it really? And you go around bowing to other gods? That's what Israel's doing. In their sin. Come on. God's trying to tell us, I love you with everything I got. And because you love me, I'm going to give you everything I got. Nothing left out. Well, how do I get it? By faith. Mix your faith with the Word of God. And start working it now. Start working it now from where you are. And believe the Lord. You've heard me say this before. It took Linda and I 20 years to get out of debt. I prayed to get out of debt for 20 years. We paid off our house twice because of a mistake that I made. But we paid it off twice. And we came out of debt. And we're not asking anybody for anything. We're living by what God has given us. And we refuse to be cheap. We refuse to not do what God tells us to do. Are you hearing what I'm saying tonight?
Yes, sir.
This is the Spirit of God talking to you.
Amen.
This is the house of the Lord. This is the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Wanting to get through to you. And he says, I have so much more for you than what you are satisfied with. Now, you don't get into pride. I'm not in pride, but I am in the presence of the Lord. And I'm going to stay there, and I'm going to live there. And I made up my mind that this spirit of Antichrist is not going to infect me, and he's not going to have any of my life. And I went to God the other day in fear and trembling, and I said, Lord, please, please hear me. And I've told the Word, Lord, about this word. I don't use please to beg. I use please because I honor him and I respect him. See, some people are begging God all the time. Please, 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 please. No, I'm not doing that. I don't do it to beg him. I do it because I respect him and I honor him. Lord, show me how to do this. Lord, help me work this out.
Amen.
And bring about your victory. And it's not going to work because you're a good man or a good person. It's going to work because Jesus Christ is Lord and you're doing what the Word of God says.
Amen.
And the more you do that Word, the more you come about and seek the Lord just enter into his presence and to live with him, the more he can use you and the more he'll do. You understand me? Come on, stand up with me. I don't know how to end this. I hear the Holy Spirit saying again to all of us, I'm on your side. I'm working with you. And I will bless you in my timing. And by my spirit. Now, if God wants to change your path, he knows how to do that.
Yes.
If he wants you to stay on the path where you are, stay where you are. One thing I can tell you, keep going.
Amen.
Don't stop. I can look at some of you, Lorraine, Karen, that one over there, LaVeya, Evelyn, I see you growing. I see you maturing in the Lord. I see you wanting the things of God and pushing into them. And that's not all of you. That's, you know, I can't remember everybody's name or speak everybody's name. But I see changes in Scott and what he's doing and what the Lord's doing through them.
Yes.
Jim Anderson, you know, we've been through some hard things together, but we're still here, and we're still growing, and we're still locked the doors when we have to. And we haven't ever brought any ammunition or guns in here.
Man.
But if we had to, we would. If it comes down to that. But we're going on with God, and God is ready to love on you because you love him, and he's going to bring about what he has for you.
Amen.
If you don't collapse and give up.
Yes, 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 yes.
If you collapse, come on up here. We'll pray with you. But you don't give up. Amen?
Amen.
Thank you, God. Lift your hands to the Lord and thank him for what he's doing in your life. Thank you, God. We celebrate you today. And this wrong spirit is driven out of us and driven out of this church. Hamas and Antichrist, you have no place in this church, no place in this family, in Jesus Christ's name. And we move you out of here. Move you out of this building in the name of Jesus Christ. Go! And we will not be regulated by what these spirits say to us.
Amen.
We will be regulated by what you say to us. And we set ourselves to be in love with you. We set ourselves to let you hear us love you.
Yes.
And we set ourselves to do those things that you ask us to do in the mighty name of Jesus.
Thank you.
Amen.
Amen.
God be the glory.
Yes.